Hello, hello. Well, welcome. Welcome, welcome to the morning service for St. George's Street Baptist Church in Macclesfield. What a bizarre time we live in. My little introductory summary comes from recent images and thoughts about lockdown, which I found on the internet. This is how some people are feeling about the situation. There are some who comment on life, some who cry for help, and some use humour as well. And saddest of all is the government website, which officially records the death toll. This is a real time. These are real people. And we all deal with these situations in different ways. Now, what we'll do this morning was, of course, aimed at the people of St. George's Street Baptist Church. But if you are a stranger to us, well, welcome, a special welcome to you. I hope you see something of God as we consider him together. Leave me a YouTube message if you like. Our church has quite an interesting name. We are St. George's Street Baptist Church, Macclesfield. But understand that our allegiance is to St. George's Street, not to St. George. We're St. George's Street Baptist Church. We're not called to fix all the things that are happening around the world, not to London, not to New York, not to Shanghai. We're called to be on this street, serving this community, and to offer what Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus Christ, has to offer to people. Jesus was not your usual prophet. He made radical claims about himself. He claimed to be the direct Son of God. But he also made radical claims about our relationship with God. And we'll have a look at that again in a moment. Many, or perhaps most of the regulars here, attend because individually they've come to believe that what Jesus said about himself was true. And if it is true, if he was who he says he was, then that puts him in a unique position to be able to reach us and teach us. There's certainly no membership fee here. And Matthew 7, verse 7 says, "Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you." So you're invited. Yes, you're invited here by me. But more importantly, you're invited here by God himself. The question is, will you stay? I hope so. Our first song is perhaps the modern classic Christian song. I read that it's estimated that it's sung 40 to 50 million times per year in the UK alone. And that makes it the most popular licensed Christian song today. Well, whether you sing it, tap it, or just listen to it, "In Christ Alone" expresses some of our feelings about Jesus. Let's enjoy it together.
In Christ.
Let's pray. The prayer will be on the screen if you'd like to read it. Father, we thank you for our time together, a time when we can be away from the everyday concerns of our lives, a time when we can come deliberately close to you, when we can choose to be quiet and reflective in front of our God, when we can choose to be attentive to your words to us. We need you always, but at this moment we need you to be part of a two-way conversation with us. Your people arching their backs to reach up to you, quietening their souls to hear you, and putting aside opinion and prejudice. And you reaching out to meet us halfway, as you've always done. A communion of people and their God, in harmony, in right relationship, and covered in the love of our Father. Make our service something this morning. Make it mean something. Make it part of our journey, yes, but part of an improving relationship with you. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. What on earth is church, eh? Isn't it an ancient institution? The point about life is that it's a journey. It isn't one experience. It's a set of experiences. You travel from one set of conditions to another. Your priorities change as you change from a child to a young person, and from a young person as you begin to form longer term relationships, as you perhaps become a parent, as you become older. And sometimes, as well you know, life throws you a curved ball. Family, friends, money, a place to live, a car crash, a lost relationship. And then comes COVID-19. It can be really difficult. So difficult that lots of people abandon their original course and move in a different direction. And then they find that the new direction is even worse than the first. As a church, what we can offer is to be part of that journey with each other. In any given circumstance, we might not be able to help, but we will be there in good times and bad. We don't abandon each other. And that's not because we're good people. It's because we're convinced that Jesus Christ is who he says he is. And that has consequences. It changes our priorities, our relationship together before God becomes a priority. And that's a church, a friend in good times and a friend in bad times, but together, rooted in Christ. Our reading today is from Colossians 2, verse 8 to 15. And you'll see it up on the screen. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Christ. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you've been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him you were also circumcised, and a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self ruled by the flesh was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having cancelled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Let's pray again, and the words will be up on the screen. Father, we pray for our world, and we start by praying small for the world immediately around us. We pray for our friends and family, whether they're close or far off. And in particular, we pray for how they are journeying through these difficult times. We pray for safety for them, with all that means at this time. And looking a little larger, we pray for a wider area, and in particular, the people of our church, for the people of this street church, and for our town where we live. We pray too for the people involved in opening up our society after COVID-19, for school teachers, for company managers, for shopkeepers and government officials, all those people who'll be making imperfect decisions with imperfect knowledge, but on whom we depend greatly. And wider still, we pray for our country, and in particular we pray for our government. In this prayer, we have no interest in politics, but we do care that right decisions can be made at crucial times. When to restart schools, when to allow shops to open, when to open public places, and when to allow holidays. And we pray too for the overall health of the nation. We've seen COVID-19 numbers improving, less people lost per day. But we still know that there are thousands grieving for loved ones who were lost before their time. We pray particularly for those who've lost multiple people. Have mercy on imperfect us, Father, at this difficult time. Show us the same care you showed when you planned, gave, and relinquished your Son. Show the same care you showed when you called us. With the love of the Father, with the presence of the Holy Spirit, with the precious grace of Jesus Christ, so deal with our nation now. Amen. We're going to have another song now. How deep the Father's love for us. In the next section, I talk a little bit about mental health, and I wanted to be clear that I'm talking about the extra stresses and strains which come as a result of COVID-19, and in particular as a result of lockdown. I'm not talking about anything else other than those things which are directly derived from how hard it is to be under lockdown. The Bible talks of two types of life, of a physical life and a spiritual life. We have a non-physical spirit and a non-physical soul, says the Bible. Well now, words such as spirit and soul are not popular today, but we do hear of non-physical mental health. And of course, mental health and spiritual health have a lot in common without ever quite being the same thing. You can have good or poor mental health, and you can have good or poor spiritual health. Both spirit and mental health are greatly influenced by physical attributes in our lives. But neither is completely determined by the physical. And then spiritual and mental health can be nurtured or damaged by events around us, by such things as gain and loss, by good news and bad news, and achievement and failure. These are some of the similarities. Yet somehow that term mental doesn't quite reach the parts that spiritual reaches. Mental health seems to be a part of us, an aspect of us. Spirit seems to be the heart of us. Perhaps I am spirit, but I have mental health. What do you think? Where the Bible does, of course, differentiate spirituality, though, is in its description of what it takes to be spiritually healthy. There are lots of strategies we can take to be mentally healthy. Inspirational speakers would have us believe that positive thinking is the answer. Gardner's World constantly talks of a healthy relationship with the natural growing world around us. Others will tell you that music soothes the soul. And there are planning systems and goal setting systems and phone apps and self-help groups to help you cope. And then, of course, there are relationships as well which can help you. And don't get me wrong, I've no beef with any of these. I use some of these systems myself. They have genuine value and they have genuine reason. They help. The question is, what are we actually achieving by improving ourselves in this way? Well, no criticism from me. I just want to ask if we need more than strategies in our spiritual side. The Bible makes it clear that in our raw state, we lack something in the spiritual part of us. And it repeats this mantra again and again. From our reading, Colossians 2 verse 13 says, "When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ." Notice the former sentence here, because it'll reappear again and again in the Bible. You were, dead in your sins. But God, did something. He made you alive with Christ. You are like this, but God did something. We're going to meet that concept again, so you might like to remember this form. You were like this, but God does something. Our spiritual health depends first on whether God has done something already. It depends on God. And that's where it departs from mental health. It shouldn't be a surprise, of course. After all, we're built in the image of God. That creation premise, that starting point, that we were built like God, points to the fact that we were intended to be with God. We might have moved on from the Garden of Eden, where we were always healthy, to garden design. Don't forget, Monty's told us that one way to stay mentally healthy is to commune with the growing process. We might have moved on from Garden of Eden to garden design, but we've always been under the watchful eye of God. Seems to me a good 50% of the Bible screams God and man together is how it should be. It's interesting to reflect on how we know about this relationship between God and man. You can patch up your mental health with many, many systems. Which one will you choose? But to understand your spiritual needs, you must turn to a reliable source. There are many religious people. There are many religious ways. There are many religious systems and many religious documents. And you can even invent one by yourself if you wish. But how do you know what is right? The Bible claims to be the Word of God. It repeatedly claims this. And no lesser a person than Jesus Christ himself based his arguments on the truth of the Scriptures on a number of occasions. And in particular, the Bible claims to tell us what God intends for us. For us right now, that means addressing the question, you were like this, but God did something. It tells us in Colossians what we were like, and it tells us what God does about it. You can't know this unless you read it in the Bible. It can't be derived by experience or experiment, although they help. Every religion, every philosophical standpoint has a different view, derived from someone's opinion. The brutal fact is, we can't be trusted as a species to come up with the right answer when it comes to these deep issues. We need the truth explained to us. If you believe that Jesus was who he said he was, then you do have a reliable source, Jesus. And the Bible is the record of that teaching. So what does the Bible teach? What is the "you were like this" part of the equation? What does the Bible say? You were dead in your sins. We are born of perishable seed. We wither like grass. We're unable to see the kingdom of God. We're just flesh born of flesh. We possess a heart of stone. We're subject to death because of sin. We're unable to come to God. We're without the Spirit. And the other bit, what has God done? We can be alive with Christ. We can be saved by grace. We can receive the love of God, which he has prepared for us. Our sins can be forgiven. We can be born again imperishable. We must hear the word of the Lord so that we endure forever. We should receive the Holy Spirit. We gain the right to become children of God. We must be born of God. We should be given birth through the word of the truth. It's what's on offer. You know, it's been said that evangelical Christians must be sad people because they know how they fall short in God's eyes. But should not it be joyful too that every shortcoming that we have has been matched by God in these passages? Did you get it? The good bits are from the same passages as the bad bits. You are like this, but God does something. Bad news immediately followed by good news. Condemnation followed by salvation. It was the work and teaching of Jesus Christ which was to make the difference in the world. Before him, war was justified, personal gain was core to our purpose. These are the depths to which mankind had sunk. I wonder if you've changed at all sometimes. But the idea that mankind worked this out for himself, well, that's just wrong. It was Jesus that taught us what is right. And that is the point. This is about us. It's about where you and I have come from and where you and I stand now in lockdown days. in the generation that lived through COVID-19. This life was chosen for us by God, in his wisdom, to match us to his decrees. This life is part of the plan that God has for us. If things are hard now, it does not mean that anything has changed. You are one for Christ. You are one by the love of God. You are one to be different. You are one to walk with God. You are one by the mercy of your Father. You are one by the suffering of Christ. We are defined by our relationship to God, not by our external circumstances. Sure, we're rooted in our inadequacies before God. Sure, we learn from not from our great knowledge, but by getting to grips with what Jesus has to say about us. But we are primarily receivers of the great and varied promises of God, the generosity of creation, mercy for inadequacies that we have before God. Before the crisis, we had every reason to be hopeful. After the crisis, when the stock exchange has crashed, ruining our pension plan, when taxes are going to rise, taking away the money we'd earmarked for ourselves, when some of us have had to beg and borrow to survive, when tens of thousands of people have been taken before their time, when our debt has risen, when we missed our holiday, in that situation, we still have reason to be hopeful. We are not COVID-19 people who go to church. We're followers of Jesus, who, by the way, were called to live through the COVID-19 pandemic of 2020. Do what you must to survive. Within reason, do what you have to do to keep yourself mentally healthy. But live, 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 because you are solid and spirit and justified and free. One for God, solely and completely, by the revelation and work of Jesus Christ. Nothing COVID-19 can do is going to change that. I hope you don't mind, but we'll finish our service with one of my songs. As always with my music, I recommend headphones because of the importance of tone in my compositions. You might like to try the opening music as well with headphones on. But if you can't manage that, that's fine. You know, the marvelous events that come together to define our lives are unique to each one of us. But there is real pattern to be discovered. And that pattern comes from the work of the Almighty. The two supreme achievements of the Almighty are creation and grace. They have no other equal under the sun. I hope this song catches them both. At the end of the song, that'll be the end of our service. Nice to meet you.
Sometimes it's enough to see the sun go down. Sometimes I don't need any more. But warmth upon my closing eyes, the color in the sky. These are things that stay the same. These are things I can't explain. Why would God do this for me? Grace so far and yet so free. What am I that I should gain? Gain and again. I get His mercy, He gets my pain. I get mercy, He gets my pain. Outside the gates of Jerusalem, the lonely man climbs a hill. I'm justified and merciless, yet prophecy fulfilled. With shameful motivation, we will crucify a king. This is how we prize God's Son. This is how our justice is done. Why would God do this for me? Grace so far and yet so free. What am I that I should gain? Gain and again. I get His mercy, He gets my pain. I get mercy, He gets my pain. A future through eternity is resting on His heart. For He can climb down any time and leave us where we are. Through biting pain and Father's scourge, what will Jesus do? Oh my God, what have we done? Crucify the Son. Why would God do this for me? Grace so far and yet so free. What am I that I should gain and again? I get His mercy, He gets my pain. I get mercy, He gets my pain.